Awesome. So I wanted to talk today about the database. And, you know, we talked about DevOps breaking down silos across organizations. And my whole hope today is just to, you know, break down that silo with your DBA division as well and just try to start thinking, you know, about the database as part of DevOps. It's, you know, not a separate thing. My name is Stephanie Kerr. I'm a product manager at Redgate Software. We make tools for database DevOps. But I'm not really focusing on our tools today. What I really wanted to do is talk to you about, you know, your databases and, again, open up this conversation. So today, I wanted to look at database deployments, what we see today and where we would like it to be, what are some of the challenges, and then just show an example that, you know, it can be done. So Clinton was talking earlier about, you know, these sessions in the morning being general because it has to relate to everybody here. This is a one-track session. So how many of you guys, like, have a back-end database system at your organization? See all hands up. Yeah. Awesome. So it was actually interesting. We look at the State of DevOps report a lot. And what we found between, Nicole was talking earlier about some of the statistics in the 2017 report, but we've actually looked further back, and between 2016 and 2017, the number of frequency of deployments between that high-performing team and low-performing team is actually decreasing. Back in 2016, high performers used to be able to deploy 200 times faster, and they used to be able to their lead time was over 2,500 times faster. So the high-performing teams were really nailing this ability to automate their deployment pipeline, to be able to release that value to their end users quickly. It was interesting, Nicole talked about value to the organization, but I really think about it as value to the end user, and again, collecting that feedback and feeding it back into the cycle. And one of the key things with DevOps is being able to automate your release process so that you are able to release those changes quickly. It gets that end user feedback and integrate it back in. So for the application, we are seeing people doing this. We are seeing them put their application in source control or version control, having it part of their continuous integration process. To me, that's really a big component. You need continuous testing as well. How good is it to automate this pipeline and, you know, not having any tests? You really want to make sure that you're building quality in and having that valuable changes flow through. Into a release management system. Is anybody here today kind of fully automated application deployment all the way out to production environments? We have a few hands. Anybody doing it for their database? A few less hands, but still some. That gives me hope. What we normally see is something like this, that the application's fully automated. It's, you know, really great, has a great test suite around it. But then the database is still kind of a separate organization, it's very siloed, and especially when it comes to deployments, that these are really tricky, these are really hard. The production DBA, you know, is kind of risk averse. They want to protect that data. They don't want to be getting the pagers in the middle of the night. So before working at Redgate, I was actually a database developer. I loved it because I didn't have to worry about the production systems and all, you know, the security and the sensitivity of the data. And when I started, we were doing deployments about once every 3 months, and this was our process. And I tell people, don't take a picture of this. This is, you know, 10 years ago. This is what we used to do. But it was, you know, this was possible because, you know, 10 years ago, people weren't expecting updates like every day, or, you know, if there was a problem, you know, that it would be fixed right away. And we were able to have this downtime. We were able to, the third Thursday of, you know, the third month, we would, at 8 p.m., get together and do a deployment. And we'd take the application offline, and we'd change the database to single user mode. And it was great. And hopefully, you know, by midnight, hopefully we were done, and we could go home. And, you know, that happens sometimes, but not all the times. And, you know, we'd hear stories a bit about this, about, you know, deployments that have gone wrong and the impact to, like, downtime that this can have on organizations and the financial costs of downtime. And we really want to, you know, try to get away from this, try to get smaller batch sizes going through. Nicole was talking about, you know, if you have a smaller change set going through, being able to understand if there is a problem, what the problem was, and fix that easier. So what we really like to do is get somewhere like this, where the database and the application live together side by side. We're pulling in best practices from the application and applying them to the database as well. It's part of your version control, part of the process, part of CI. There is such a thing as database unit testing. It's amazing, but it does happen. But also other kinds of automated tests, like integration tests or smoke level tests that can be performed out in testing environments. And we still have this production DBA here. There's still, just if you're practicing these practices doesn't mean you have to do complete continuous deployment all the way up to production. You can still have that safety net. You can still have somebody in the process that's going to review it. But you don't want to make it a hugely manual process for them. You want it to be a click of a button that was really easy. So when I've been reading a lot about DevOps, again, I feel like the database is sometimes left behind. And a lot of people will say it's really hard to define DevOps. I think we're getting closer now. But I went back to Patrick Dubois, which Clinton had mentioned earlier, who started DevOps Days. And I was trying to see, what does he say about DevOps? And this was, from a presentation he did back in 2011 about, it's not only when things go wrong collaborating, but working together across all these teams all the time. And he talked a lot about, DevOps, if you really, narrow it down and focus, it is about developer and operations, but that's just a really small subset. Really, DevOps, in his definition, goes much beyond that across all of the people in the organization and really changing the culture, changing the way you're thinking about it. So it's kind of sad that Patrick forgot to mention DBAs on this slide. It's still the unforgettable person. But it was great to see that when he was talking about it, it's not just devs and ops, it's sysadmins, testers, architects, network. We talk a lot about security now. So again, this is much bigger than just the application and the operations and deploying that, but getting all these groups working together. So now I want to talk about some of the challenges. What do you guys think is the biggest challenge of including your database or doing database releases? Oh, I heard some whispers. The biggest challenge.
Schema changes.
Schema changes, and why is that?
Backwards and forwards.
Schema changes because the data, right? The data, the production data, the business critical production data. And this is what DBAs for the last 40 years, what their focus has been, protecting that data, making sure that when a deployment happens, you're not corrupting any data, you're not risking the security of that data, making sure users that shouldn't have access to that data are getting access to it, making sure you're not losing any data. Anybody done, delete from table, forget the where clause? Hopefully not on production. But that data, and so for production DBAs, for the past 40 years, this has been where their focus has been, protecting that data, keeping it safe. Any kind of change is risky, any kind of change, oh my gosh, is that gonna impact the performance? Am I gonna get a call in the middle of the night? Do I have the right backups in place? What's my disaster recovery? So this is really challenging. Has anybody heard of GDPR? GDPR, General Data Protection Regulations. Does anybody work with customers in Europe? Collect customer European information? Those two, okay, that's why you've heard of it then. This is some new regulation for customers in Europe to try to better regard their protection of their data. So this has been something in the work for the past 4 years, and it goes into effect May 2018. So I talk a lot with European companies, and this is a huge, huge, huge thing for them. And I think more and more, the U.S. is going to make stricter regulations as well about protecting the data. Also, if a breach happens, the reporting of that data, and also the financial penalties to companies if a breach happens. So again, I think this is a good regulation. I think it's more about protecting the data, making sure that companies are safeguarding our information. So I think this is a good thing. But this is, again, increasing that that risk and that problem of DBAs and really wanting to protect that production database. Some other challenges with database, when I think about version controlling a database, I think about version controlling schema changes. I also think about configuration data. So this is data that needs to be tracked in version control so you can understand how it changes, and then deployed through the pipeline alongside the schema changes. And there's some more challenges in this around customer-specific data. So sometimes you might have this set of data has to go to customer A, and this set has to go to customer B. And this just makes it much more difficult, much more challenging, because you know it might be the same application that runs, but different customer data sets. Also, we have test data. And ideally, what's the best type of test data?
Production data,
right? A big concept in DevOps is shifting left and catching issues earlier. And everybody I talk to wants to take that production data and move it into their dev environment so that they can test against it and make sure it's going to work. Didn't I just mention GDPR and HIPAA and security and compliance? So this isn't going to work. But what we do want is realistic test sets. And potentially, as you move through your environments, you know, maybe development, maybe you don't have all the data. But maybe in a testing environment with more limited access, maybe there is data. Maybe you use a data masking tool to mask sensitive data. Maybe you have a pre-prod environment that you can spin up, and it is an exact copy of production, and you can test your deployments against that before doing your actual production upgrade. So the closer we can get to that production-like set of test data earlier in our pipeline, I think it's the better to find issues and find problems. So things I see here is either companies maintaining a set of scripts with insert statements to put some data in those earlier environments. There's SQL data generation tools out there to generate data. And again, there's data masking tools. So what kind of things to think about? Another problem with databases is the size of the database. Now, for some companies, this might not be a problem. You might have small databases. For other companies, if you're talking about terabytes of data, you know, how do you replicate this in all of your environments and all the space that's required? And again, you might have something like this where, you know, in addition to your pipeline, you also have staging environments for your customers, which is just, you know, what is this now? 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times, you know, terabytes of data. It's just massive amounts of data. And I think we're in a trend where it's more likely that we're just collecting more data, and keeping that data for longer periods of time. So this problem is just increasing. So again, I've seen things at work here where you only have a subset of data in your early environments. I'm really excited about a potential opportunity of containers in this space and being able to spin up a database on the fly, you know, loading it with some data and throwing it away so you're not taking up all that space all the time. And solutions in the cloud can help with this as well. Again, can you put your data in the cloud? That's another question, but there are some options of how you can work with this. And this is another favorite of mine. When I usually talk to DBAs, and I said, how many times have you made a change to the production database directly? And almost every single hand goes up. And I don't fault that. I think, you know, in some cases, there are times in emergency situations where you'll need to make a change to your production environment. The database drift is when, you know, you expect your production database to be at one state, and then because of a hotfix or something, it's not at the same state you expected at it. And if you're doing automated deployments, and you aren't aware of your production environment and how it shifted or drifted, you're going to overwrite those changes, and that could have, you know, a negative impact on your release, or the production hotfix you just made, you've now reintroduced the break. So it's really important to monitor and understand changes that are being happening in production, and making sure that you're including them back in your earlier upstream environments to make sure that those changes aren't being overwritten. And zero downtime deployments. Does anyone have this requirement? A few hands, okay. You have the requirement, can you meet the requirement? So this is actually really, really hard. And a lot of the times when I work with a consultant in the UK that works across lots of companies doing this, and they say, you know, for the bigger database changes, if you can afford downtime, you know, make sure you take that schedule maintenance window. So in some environments, that's still okay. In other environments, you really need to think about your database changes and the backwards compatibility. So there are things where if you need to split a column, you can split the column, create two new columns, you know, have an asynchronous script that's running batch updates of that data to move into those new columns at a time. And then you need to somehow deal with that in-between state, either in the application or through a database view or something where you can deal with, you know, the two sets of different columns, the two sets of different database schema, while the update of the data is happening in the background. And I do like tools that can, you know, monitor like performance or trends of usage on your database. And for those times where you do need a lot of data updates, you know, why not schedule something during a time where you know peaks are low? So hopefully there is less impact to the system. Rolling back. So it's so important when, again, that production data is critical. And when I was doing database development, my database was really small. And I was so fortunate. I could take a backup, you know, in a few minutes, and I had my whole database backed up. And therefore, if there was a problem with the release, I could roll it back really quickly just by restoring that production database backup. So nowadays, again, if your backup's going to take hours to create and then hours to restore, that's a long time to be offline. So, you know, rolling back a stored procedure can be pretty simple because it doesn't impact that data. Rolling back a schema change, you need to be thinking about that. And you need to be deciding what you do with that data. Is it okay to lose the new data that you captured because you're rolling it back? Or do you need to script off that changes to somewhere else before rolling it back? And what do you do with the application in the meantime? Is there a way to put the application in a read-only state or a downtime message or something so that you can fix this and get back online as soon as possible? But another thing we like to talk about is instead of rolling back, try to roll forward that change. If you have this automated pipeline in place where your database change can simply be pushed through another one, you know, think about rolling forward a change to fix the problem instead of having to revert back. We've heard this already today, but maintaining backwards compatibility. I work with a team that does ringed releases, so they're kind of using feature flags. And they're able to, or canary releases. So they're able to specify for this release, only, you know, the first 100 users can access this new feature. But let everybody else stay on the old version because I want to make sure there's no problems for these first 100 users before I open it up to the next set, before I open it up to everybody. So in this type of situation, your database needs to support both, you know, the current set that everybody's on, but also those 100 users that are on the new set. And, you know, you have to really, it's not just, you know, something that you might be able to solve in the database. You can solve with different stored procedures and parameters and views, but it might also be something that you have to do on the application side, and on the application side, understand which stored procedure you're calling. But you need to be thinking about this and make sure that your database is backwards compatible or forwards compatible to those future versions. So even more challenges. I mentioned the DBA. The DBA, again, for the last 40 years, their focus has been on protecting that production data. I feel like DBAs are very unfamiliar with a lot of the techniques that have been used for application. So about 8 years ago, if we asked DBAs if you had your database in version control, they'd be like, version control? What's that? You know, these tool sets just aren't there in the database world. And they're getting better. And they're getting there, but you know, I think the real problem here is that the organization is so siloed. So being able to talk to the DBAs, being able to involve them in why you want to, you know, come together on this process. And again, don't, you know, DBAs are not just going to give developers sysadmin rights to their production machine. And I don't think that's what DevOps is about. I think it's working together, using each of the team's strengths to come up with a process that works for your organization. Other challenges include environmental differences. I'm working with a company right now where they have they deploy up to customer sites. The customers install the database. Well, some customers are using SQL Server 2008. Some are on SQL Server 2012. You know, some are on SQL Server 2016. Some are moving to the cloud. So they are creating a lab where they can spin up containers with different SQL Server versions on those containers to run their automated tests against. And this is working really well for them. And I think it's a great way to be able to test across a lot of different SQL Server versions, along with environmental differences. So let's say like on production, you might have replication or different things. So you need to be aware of those environmental differences. And I do strongly recommend having that staging environment that's as close as possible to production so that you have more confidence in your deployment before clicking that button to go to production. And finally, dependencies. In DevOps world, architecture is really important, and going from monolithic to microservices. And I still see a lot of monolithic databases out there, but I see a lot of databases that, it's a huge database and it also references this other databases. So, and those databases might have connectivity in your production system, but you might not have connectivity in your lower downstream environments. So how do you mock out that secondary database to make sure that, you can test your deployments better? So it's a lot of challenges. It is really hard, but what I wanted to leave you on was a positive note that even though it's hard, it is possible. So I just wanted to show a quick example of how this could work. And it all starts with getting your database in version control. And I see a few ways of doing this. You can script out all your database changes, your alter statements, your update statements, script them out, check them into a version control system. But there's also tools out there that help. And I'm talking a lot of focus in the relational database management space right here, but I hope some of this applies to other database systems as well. In the tools, I see two types of approaches. I see what is sometimes referred to as a state-based or a model-based or declarative-based. This is kind of like DSC, desired state configuration, where in source control you're storing the DDL, the creation script of every single object. So between version 1, version 2, you have how each object looks. And then at deployment time, a script is generated, which would be run against your target environment to bring it up to version 2. That's great. You just have to understand that sometimes there's less control over the scripts that get generated. Because you don't understand the intent of the change. And also, if it's just doing the schema, what about that reference data that needs to be deployed as well? Or what about any transactional data that needs to be updated as part of the system? So I feel like those things still need to be scripted out and put into version control. The other tool takes more of a migrations approach. Sometimes people use this with entity framework migrations to update their database through migrations. And what happens is every single update statement or alter statement is put into source control. And then at deployment time, these scripts are concatenated and ran on the production system to do the upgrade. There's some problems with this as well. Excessive scripts, if you're depending on how many changes you have, you could have a lot of changes. You can't see the object level history because you could have a change table in this script, change table in this script. Branching and merging. You're never going to have a conflict. Even if two different scripts are working against the same table or the same stored procedure, you don't have conflicts. And then running those deployment scripts, if you change a table in one script and another script, is going to update multiple times. So just real quick, we'll jump into a demo to see just an example of how it could work in simple situations. So I'm just going to go ahead and add a new script, and in that script I'm going to update, sorry, the resolution's pretty low, I'm going to make a change to a table, I'm going to update this table, we collect person information, and I'm going to add a Twitter ID column. Let's go ahead. So I'm in my development world. I'm developing this against my development database. If I look in Management Studio and query the database, nope. being altered, that's why it didn't work. Alter the table and add that column. Alter table. Okay, so now in my development database, I have this new Twitter ID. I could, you know, change the script to update information in that column. And what I'm going to do now is commit this to source control. So it's really nice when you have a one-to-one, this application goes with this database, and I would recommend putting them into the version control system side by side so that they can be versioned, they can be branched together, the changes can be tracked together, and they can also be released together. So this is going into my version control system now. For this example, I'm using Team Foundation Server, but really works with anything, Git, Subversion, anybody still using Subversion? Wow, okay. So again, in the repository, my database changes are tracked alongside the application changes. And Clinton was very nice to lend me his phone for the Wi-Fi, so hopefully I'm not having any conference Wi-Fi issues. So as part of the repository, I can see all my changes to my database. This is that new script we just added. I have this set up so that this automatically kicks off a build with my continuous integration process. And what I should see is if I go to my my other database, which is my integration, so this is what gets updated as a result of my CI process, we should see that once the build completes, and oh, it's still in progress. So once this completes, we should see a new Twitter ID on, there it goes, it's successful, on our integration environment. Oh, sorry, the build completed. For a build, this is just checking that there's no SQL error in the build. It's also checking for any dependencies. But what, and also what it does, same with application, is you're packaging up your database changes in an artifact. And then that artifact's going to be picked up by your release process. And then same thing in application, you build once, you deploy everywhere, and you have that interchangeable artifact. That's what happens. So now that my release is complete, now when I go over to my integration environment and execute that query again, I now have that Twitter ID there. So doing future deployments, because I'm using tools that are, you know, the same tools that I'd be using for my application, it's just a click of a button. Instead of trying to find that script and opening SSMS and making sure I have my connection right. So really easy to integrate your database changes, simple changes anyway, into the process. And I just jump back to slides. So there's a difference between releasing to non-prod and production environments. Non-prod, I'd say, hey, if it passed some basic tests, just keep going. Production environments, you may want that gated check or that DBA check to review the script, to be able to see what changed, which objects were changed. Any kind of warnings, if my script involves something that's changing users or granting permissions, those are things I want to flag up and make sure that a DBA has an extra look at. Any kind of changes that in my pre-prod or staging environment take a really long time to run, those are things I want to look at closer and make sure that I'm not going to take production down while trying to do the upgrade. So we talked today about database deployments, how we see them today, where we would like them to be, the challenges, and also showed an example of how this could be done, including your database alongside your application in your version control, CI, and CD. So just a final note, how many of you guys have seen the Velocity 2009 presentation from John Alsball and Paul Hammond? Okay, this presentation I think is amazing. This is what inspired Patrick DeBois to kick off the DevOps conference in Ghent. And the very last slide, he said, this is not easy. you could just carry on chatting at each other. So this is how they were deploying at Flickr, you know, 10 deployments a day. So this gives me a lot of hope. You know, in 2009, they were saying how hard this was to do for the application. And now, you know, from the State of DevOps report that Nicole was showing, you can see teams are doing this for the application. So, you know, this is really hard for the database, and you could continue doing what you are doing, but I think we can get better, and I think in a few years, hopefully, we'll say database releases are just as boring as it is for the application.